acoustics are good enough. I don't need a microphone, right? Dear Hortz, dear graduates, proud families, esteemed faculty, friends, a decade and a half ago I stood here, as you are now, not having ever imagined that the day would come when I would be asked to send off a graduating Horstein cohort on its path to do great things for the Jewish world. Receiving an award from the Horstein program is a great honor in itself. But receiving an award named after Bernard Riesman, a man, a mensch, and a master educator whom I had personally known and deeply loved, is a different feeling altogether. I'm deeply humbled by it, as Bernie Riesman and his Horstein faculty peers, some of whom are present here today, played a vital role in shaping my own thoughts on Judaism, on education, and most importantly, on the need to negotiate raw passion with intellectual integrity, conviction with practical skill, and the understanding that people will forever be far more complex, challenging, and beautifully unique to succumb to any theoretical canopy that wishes to bind them and their needs as one. The time I spent in Bernie's orbit has shaped my own professional trajectory, and his words served as constant and precious context in many conjunctions along my path. Much like most experiences that stir a deep chord, Bernie's presence stretched far beyond its physical expanse. While my time with him had to end at a certain point, it never truly concluded. His words, teachings, and wisdom continue to echo in my mind and inform my thoughts on a myriad of professional as well as personal issues. In one recorded interview, Bernie summarizes in plain words his vision for future Jewish professional leaders. What I feel is needed by future leaders of Jewish communities in America and elsewhere in the world, Bernie says, are individuals who can move beyond their own egos to capture the needs and interests of the folks out there, to be sufficiently sensitive to their hungers and aspirations, and to give them not only ideas, but values drawn from 4,000 years of Jewish wisdom. Of those 4,000 years of Jewish wisdom, I feel comfortable today to say that I've already mastered about a month and a half. But it is a precious month and a half, of which I would like to share with you a little gem. Our collective Jewish narrative arguably revolves around that seminal moment at Mount Sinai, a moment usually acknowledged as God's revelation to the entire community of Israel. This communal aspect of revelation arguably distinguishes the Jewish theological constitution from all others. And its impact on our Jewish consciousness and sense of communal cohesion and responsibility is obviously profound. However, this enigmatic communal revelation at Sinai, smoke, tremor, a booming voice from above, was not the only thing that happened that day, albeit what I'm about to disclose here might not have made it to Charlton Heston's version of the Ten Commandments. Something else happened there, at least in our rabbi's imagination of that moment, and whose lesson may serve us all very well as aspiring leaders of a community. Midrash Rabbah discloses this enigmatic moment and which features Moses and God in dialogue on top of the mountain. As the book of Exodus 19:19 says, Moses spoke, and God replied with a voice. Where Midrash Rabbah now continues to ask, why does it say that God replied in a voice, rather than just saying that Moses spoke and God answered? To which it answers now, Rabbi Luliani says, when the Torah says that Moses spoke and God replied in a voice, it means that God replied using Moses' own voice. Which now begs the question, what did Moses hear? At that dramatic moment of revelation, Moses heard himself. At that seminal point, Moses was not having a dialogue with God as a separate other, but what I would like to call an enriched monologue, based on deep awareness of one's place in the life of a nation. This profoundly intimate moment in what is what we should all look for. Revelation does not necessarily have to appear in a booming voice from above, but rather in a silent whisper of an awakened soul from within. Sinai, we may learn here, is not just a physical mountain to be witnessed by a community, but a mental backdrop for the individual inner quest that compels us as we strive to fulfill our potential on this earth. Indeed, the term Jewish professional leaders might not adequately articulate the fuller scope of what I believe you are set to do. For you are, in truth, individuals who received a mandate from our community to traverse the magnificent landscapes of Jewish spaces, times, ideas, and values, and weave them into a story whose backbone is filled with meaning, relevance, challenge, pride, and awe. You're not simply storytellers, my friends, but story bearers, actual and significant players in the unfolding story that you yourselves now set to narrate. Make sure, my friends, to harness the language of meaning as you embody that story in your lives. For it has been way too long that we have forsaken that path for the sake of ritual and practice alone. We taught our people how to be Jewish without addressing the vital question of why to be Jewish. In a historical perspective, this triumph of ritual over meaning yields a most regrettable outcome, a generation that deals only with ritual, devoid of a meaningful discussion over its meaning, is ultimately bound to lose both. Many of us grew believing that the mandate bestowed upon educators is to resolve questions, ease the burden of dilemmas, and combat ambiguity in general. The students, some maintain, are those with the questions, whereas we are supposed to harness our wisdom, erudition, knowledge, and overall experience towards answers. There is indeed no doubt that such a task sounds commendable, had it not arguably been restricted to the acquisition of information, in Hebrew, Meida, in its more basic form. Yet our mandate, if taken seriously, is not to inform, but to transform. Not merely give information, but lead people in a process wherein information is the means towards a superior level of inquiries, which now wrestle with context, relevance, values, and beliefs whose stake, I maintain, is nothing short of existential. This level, which I render yeda, knowledge, is indispensable on one's journey towards forming an opinion, de'ah in Hebrew. All of these words come from the same root, about life, its overall backbone, and one's commitment to its perpetuation as an individual and as a member of a community. Indeed, as aspiring leaders of such journeys, Bernie's call to contextualize our work within the values drawn from 4,000 years of wisdom serves to demonstrate the acute relationship between memory and commemoration. The Jewish mindset has always sought to infuse the perceptive with the active, to merge idea with deed. This viewpoint is well articulated in our Shema Yisrael prayer upon reciting, "And you shall bind them as a sign on your hand," read deed, "and as frontlet between your eyes," read idea. We are indeed story bearers who may help others understand their own vital role in this continuous and ever-evolving Jewish story. Thus, my friends, the commitment to memory is not merely a call to remember, but also a call to remember. Rejoin our people as vital members of the collective and unfolding story. This view requires an educational approach that might be rendered counterintuitive at first. For people never arrive at the educational table as a clean slate, devoid of information, things they think they know, and even formed opinions about many issues that plague them. In truth, many a time, education needs to wrestle with the profound disparity between low levels of knowledge and very high levels of opinion. The true promise of our educational vision therefore does not lie with giving answers to questions, but with our ability to identify such pre-existing exclamation points and remassage them into question marks again, and do so in supportive, meaningful, and empowering manners. Education at its core should always be a humbling process, not merely a gratifying one. Indeed, Bernard Wiesman's charge for us to move beyond our own egos serves as a constant reminder of the humility that should encompass the educational process. None of my words should resonate with you unless you are willing to befriend the enchanting ambiguity which is the emblem of any true quest for meaning and the true sign of any soul on its way to maturity. None of these precepts requires your true attention unless followed by a genuine desire to push yourselves beyond your own zone of comfort and embodying your own lives, the unrelenting search for context, depth, and conviction. None of these ideas should take hold in your hearts unless you are ready to plant seeds whose fruits you might not live to witness. You're standing here today as graduates of a renowned academic institution, trained by people whose voices, opinions, books, and ideas have and continue to shape Jewish discourse worldwide. Should you desire, the professional journey that awaits each and every one of you may pave your trajectory towards serious leadership positions in the Jewish world. A word of caution, my friends, as this word leadership is one often used, yet without much clarity. For at its heart, leadership is fueled by one's ability to have a vision that surpasses one's sight. It compels the mind and arrests the heart as one is plagued by the disparity that exists between what one sees and what one wishes to see and believes one can actually see. Leadership combines the passion of a revolutionary vision with the wisdom in allowing evolution to see it to fruition. Leadership, my friends, is our ability to turn the world in which we live into a world in which we believe. Allow me to conclude with the following words as you embark on your journey today. Whether we like it or not, one day in the future, all of us are going to become part of our people's past. And the question of what kind of a past we want to be to our future is our question for the present. I would like to bless you with becoming and aiming to structure a Jewish present which will become a past worthy of remembering and remembering. Batzacha, and God bless you all.